And now, the Business Experience Show.
Welcome to the Business Experience Show. I'm Lisa Caprelli. With us is Cole Smith. We have a wonderful guest today also. Welcome.
Well, hello. It's a pleasure to be here.
How was your drive coming down here from Hollywood?
Well, it was, it was all right. There was a bit of traffic.
There was.
Well, there was not a game, but there was some sort of happening. I think maybe it's because I was here.
I think so.
People know when I'm in town.
Do they now?
They do.
What is it usually like for you? What is your entourage like?
Well, I have 300 or 400, 500 people that follow me. And the thing is, I like to narrate wherever I am.
Is that right?
I narrate what's happening. Like right now, the Business Experience Show. What an experience it is, sitting behind the microphone, talking to people I don't know, asking uncomfortable questions.
You are so popular. You must get requested for all kinds of events, movies.
Oh, I do bar mitzvahs, whatever you want.
Yeah.
I'm hurting for cash right now. No, I'm just kidding.
Today's guest is a remarkable Josh Robert Thompson. He does impressions of Arnold Schwarzenegger.
What are you talking about?
Matthew McConaughey.
All right.
And many more. He regularly goes toe-to-toe with Craig Ferguson on The Late Late Show as robot Geoff Peterson. His comedy shorts on YouTube have more than 7 million views. And his voiceover work is too extensive to list. Welcome, Josh Robert Thompson.
Thanks for having me.
Is that your real voice?
This is my real voice. I don't even know. This is my announcer voice. It's the Business Experience Show. Sweet. Borax Soap presents. I don't know. No, this is my real voice, I think. I've forgotten what my real voice was.
Yeah, before the show, I like Matthew McConaughey. So in the Matthew McConaughey voice, tell us how you got started in comedy.
All right. You know, it's great. It's great to be here. You guys are great. And it's a great show. I tell you what, I like telling jokes. You know, I did a movie called The Lincoln Lawyer.
That was a great movie.
You're going to need to see it. If you haven't seen it on video right now, I just drive around in a Lincoln. And I do lawyer things. It's great. All right, I'm going to go play some bongos, take my shirt off. Wow. Matthew McConaughey.
Yeah.
How about that?
So tell us how you got started in comedy and your business experience. This is a business experience show of Josh Robert Thompson.
Thank you.
It really is.
Very serious. As a child, I had a full business plan, portfolio by the age of 5. I knew what my business was going to be. No, I think the recipe for being a comedian is to grow up an only child in the Midwest.
Right.
That'll do it.
That'll do it
for you.
Did your mother always know that you were going to be this and nothing else?
I think so. I think she hoped that wasn't the case. No, I spent a lot of time.
You must have made her laugh all the time.
I did, and cry. I made her cry a lot as well. But being an only child, you know, I watched a lot of TV and I listened to a lot of radio.
Uh-huh.
I listened to a lot of radio, man. I listened to old shows, like reruns.
What got in your head that you could do voices? I mean,
well, listening to these things. My grandmother, when I was 7, bought me a Fisher-Price tape recorder.
Oh.
And I started to record and play back my voice, and I was fascinated. It's magic.
God.
To hear yourself. You know,
wow.
Now we take it for granted. I do it on my phone, bro. Nobody cares.
Did anybody listen besides you?
No. No. I was my own audience.
Yeah, right,
you know?
Exactly.
But no, a lot of people. I used to make these tapes, old radio plays, because I'd listen to old shows like The Shadow, The Jack Benny Show. You know,
wow.
I mean, these are old, like Milton Berle. This is the stuff I liked because I'm 87 years old. But and that's what I mimicked. It's all about mimicry and listening, and so that's what I wanted to do.
But you got to realize it's a gift, because no one can just listen and then replay that.
What are you talking about? Everybody can do it. Just put your video on YouTube, and you're a star.
Oh, yeah.
You don't need to have talent. Look, I'll teach you how to do the impression so the world can do the same impression I do. No, you're right. You have to love it. You have to really want to do this for a living. There are a lot of people that say, I'd like to try that out. I don't think that's the attitude to take when you're getting into comedy or show business. You have to really want it.
What joy do you get out of your work?
I'll tell you, making people laugh mm-hmm. is a pretty amazing thing. When I was in high school, we did a performance of Oklahoma.
Wow.
Big show, big with the kids. Kids love that in high school.
How does the song go?
I don't know. Can we say that? Is it copy? Oklahoma with a ba 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 ba. That's all I remember.
Okay.
And I played Ali Hakim, the sort of traveling salesman.
Yes.
And I had this one scene in the show where I had to say this funny line of dialogue as I made my exit. And as I'm exiting, the crowd went wild. And, you know, I'm in high school. I was a junior in high school. And I turned to my theater teacher and I said, did I do something wrong? And she said, no, they love you. And so the next night I went out and did it again, but I really played it up and I got an even bigger laugh. I love that idea that you can have a crowd of people that you don't know in a darkened auditorium and you can affect them in some way. You can communicate to them something that's going to make them laugh. And you can make money doing it, too.
Yeah.
Back to the business part.
Was it at that point that you decided
that
to go that direction?
That was the moment in my life when I said, I really want to be on stage and I like this idea of making things up. And getting a reaction. Because the thing I did on stage was something that wasn't really planned the way that I did it.
Okay.
So I thought, wow, you don't have to just go by the book. And that's how I got into improvisation.
Oh, right.
I love that energy. Every night on The Late Late Show, Craig Ferguson and I, we do not talk before the show. We do not plan what we're going to do. We do it on purpose. We don't want to know. I don't want to hear it. Sometimes we'll do, I don't want to hear it. Don't say it. Don't even talk to me.
Wow.
Once the show starts, we have no idea what we're going to do. And that's an awesome energy.
Yeah.
It can also really, you know, fail badly, but usually it doesn't. Usually
okay,
it's great.
Okay, so I want to go a little bit order
yes,
of your life.
Let's
so,
do it.
So you have your business
high school,
plan
right.
at age five.
Business plan,
and then
yeah.
Oklahoma, then you make people happy.
Right.
You said, I could want to do this. I want this energy around me all this time.
Right.
It's breaking the ice. People love you. It opens doors for you. And then tell us what happens
well,
next.
The key to this story is to leave Cleveland.
Okay.
Okay.
Oh, why?
Well, I'm just, I can't, listen, folks, if you're out there and you're in Cleveland and you want to make it in the business, get out right now. Get out. Get out. Do it now. Because it's not going to happen for you. You know, you could do local news. That's fine.
Uh-huh.
Get out of Cleveland immediately.
Okay.
I love Cleveland. I was happy to grow up there. But I moved to California.
Good.
That was the thing.
Good idea.
I moved to California in 96.
Mm-hmm.
And I started to do public access television.
And you said that's where you learned a lot about the business, production, background.
Absolutely. I did get my degree at Cal State Fullerton in TV, radio, and film.
Yeah. Did you find that by chance, public access?
I did. I was living in Chino near the men's prison.
How you doing? You want to stop by and bring me some food?
Now, I wasn't in the prison. I was near the prison. And
I moved him out from Cleveland.
Yes.
Yeah. Who's the new guy? I'm from Cleveland. The Cleveland kid. All right. There's your cell.
None of that happened. But I was watching TV, and on the public access channel, they have a bulletin, community bulletin board. It'd be like, bake sale Thursday night. Come on out to the baseball game. And then there was something that said, do you want to work in television? Now hiring interns at the public access studio in Chino. So I went there. I took the free classes.
Cool.
And I did that for 10 years. I did my own shows for 10 years because you had your own TV studio at your disposal.
Right.
For free.
Right.
And I did it for 10 years. I did all of my characters. I honed my comedy craft. I learned the technology, producing, directing, all of it. I owe everything to public access.
And you say that that's different now than where people have access to YouTube and they're able to do things behind the scenes.
Yeah.
And before the show, we talked about how you didn't want to do YouTube and Facebook.
No, because it's this funny thing. I mean, you have to do it, unfortunately. I say unfortunately because...
Right.
There's still an air of amateurishness about it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, this is the funny thing about the 21st century. I'm on a TV show. I'm on a national television show. And, you know, kids will say, yeah, well, I got a million views in a year. And I'll be like, son, I got, 2.5 million views a night.
Right.
Yeah, but you're on TV. Nobody cares. I have a website where I sell my own T-shirts. I make six figures a year sitting in my computer.
He's right. He does. The top 10 YouTubers make, you know, six figures a year.
Yeah.
And they're not funny.
Yeah.
That's my opinion.
Right.
But there's still something about TV. There's still something about the magic of going to a physical place
mm-hmm.
and doing that thing. It's a real skill. And I think YouTube's great, though, because public access is very limited to the city in which you are doing the show.
Right.
You know, it has it didn't have much of a range as far as how many people you reach unless you bicycle your tapes all over the place. YouTube is worldwide.
So having talent like yourself combined with being able to go on YouTube, it's just opened up way more doors for you. And what has happened in the last 3 years of your life that has really, I mean, you have really skyrocketed?
Well,
your career.
It's been amazing. I mean, I started doing the public access show.
Mm-hmm.
I was discovered by a writer on The Late Late Show, mm-hmm. Joe Strazzulo, who was writing a bunch of sketches.
Mm-hmm.
He and his buddy were hanging out, and they saw my public access show, where I do this preacher character.
Right.
And he emailed me and said, dude, I want you to be on our show. And I said, yeah, all right. Well, what show do you do? And he's like, The Late Late Show with Craig Ferguson. Oh, really? Great. So I started doing The Ferguson Show because of public access in 2007, right?
Yes.
And that I did that for years and years until Craig Ferguson came to me and said, hey, we have this robot that we're putting on the show.
Uh-huh.
Oh, that's cool. Can you do the voice for it? I said, sure, I'll do the voice for it. So I did the voice of Geoff the Robot in 2010.
How does that voice?
Oh, well, he sort of sounds like George Takei. Oh, my. Oh. Most of the things he says, I can't say. But he, okay. One of his phrases is, in your pants. So I started doing the voice. It was pre-recorded. And then in 2011, I said, Craig, we should start doing this live. So now I puppeteer this character live in the studio.
Right.
Okay. The other thing is, through YouTube, a British production company saw my impressions video. It's called Four Impressions, where I do my Morgan Freeman. They were looking for a white guy who sounds like Morgan Freeman to do their commercial campaign for an insurance company called More Than Insurance. I am now the face and voice of More Than Insurance. I'm More Than Freeman.
You're More Than Freeman.
I'm selling insurance.
Yeah, I've got a question. I want to take two steps backwards and ask you to, from the public access.
Yeah.
From a business perspective, when you were there and in the studio, is that where you learned the business or the creative side?
I think that was the creative side.
Okay.
Yeah, because I wanted to know how to do my own show, so I learned all of the technology.
And you need to do that.
The cameras and all that stuff. But YouTube, I think, was where I learned to begin to market myself.
Okay.
What is it the audience wants? What audience am I going for?
Well, you needed to learn how to put together what your product was going to be.
Right.
So that sounds like what you did at Public Access.
It's a double-edged. I recommend to any actor or performer out there, learn how to edit your own stuff. I have a production background already from Cal State Fullerton, so I edit my own demos. I edit all of my stuff, and I know how that side works. It's a great skill to have in this business because you have to have both.
Oh, absolutely.
You're not
at the mercy of waiting for someone.
Well, you don't have to if you know that skill.
Right. We have Mr. Matthew McConaughey now. We have so many celebrities today.
Well, I came back.
Thank you.
I know you're a big
fan. I
get to
sit next to Matthew McConaughey.
I'm also here as well, Robert Downey Jr. Here's the deal. Love the show. Love the dress. Love what you're doing. Looks great. Good looking guy over there. You guys are sexy. Great. Keep it up.
Jarvis,
can I get the suit, please? That's great.
You'll come back for us, Mr. McConaughey?
I'll be right back, sure.
Hey, are you making any money with that on YouTube?
You know, you can make some money on the YouTubes.
Yes, you can.
Yeah, the YouTube partner program. If your videos, it's true. It's crazy. You can make, you know, every time someone clicks an ad on your video, as mm-hmm. long as your video doesn't
ching, ching, ching.
You know, and the money rolls in. I mean, it's not that easy, but it can be. Mm-hmm. It can be. There's kids that make six figures.
You have a strong take on making it in comedy today, Josh. Do you really need an agent to make it?
No, you know what? I'm going to read you a quote from Patton Oswalt, one of my favorite comics.
Please do.
He's actually the voice of Remy the Rat from the movie Ratatouille. Here's a guy that's been in comedy for years and years, mm-hmm. right? And now he's doing voices in animated films. He's parlayed his career into many different directions. But he was at the Montreal Comedy Festival, huge, the biggest comedy festival in the world. And he was talking about people making it in this day and age.
Right.
And he says, not being lucky and not being given are no longer going to define your career as a comedian and as an artist. A lot of you out there, you, for instance, the person I'm writing to, your podcast is amazing. Your videos on your YouTube channel are getting better and better every single one that you make, just like when we did open mics, better and better every week. So he's basically saying the middleman doesn't exist anymore. You don't have to.
Nope.
It's not like, go down to the club tomorrow night, the Cabana Club. The manager, Joey, he wants to see you do 5 minutes, and then he'll decide. You know, it's like, hey, Joey just watched your video on YouTube. He's going to give you a 30-minute spot on Comedy Central. That's how it works, though.
Yeah, the world is your oyster.
I mean,
if you're aggressive and you understand the tools, guys, you can do, you're unlimited. That's basically what you're saying.
Yes, understand the tools, be aggressive, know how to use this stuff, but also, you know, it still counts for something, thankfully, to be good at what you do. You've got to have that ability. Although, in the case of the Kardashians, okay, that's an anomaly, but I'm just saying. But yeah, I think things have changed. I think things are even better now because you do have more opportunity to put your stuff out there.
Yep.
And it definitely happens.
Strategically. You still got the talent of doing one thing, but you need to really focus on how you strategically reach that 100 million mark like some of these kids that are getting pulled onto the movies.
Yeah.
They figured it out.
Wow.
Don't ask me why. Is that talent? Would you say that's talent?
I think the kids are more marketing savvy now.
Yep.
They really are. They're just born knowing how that works.
Right.
And I had to struggle. I'm 37, and I'm like, I can't get any views on my YouTube, but I'm on TV. That's fine.
Partner with those guys.
Yeah. People email me and say, hey, we should do a video together. And I'm like, look, kid, I'm on TV. Yeah, you need more views. No, why? But it's kind of true.
Josh, you recently posted a video as Robert De Niro celebrating his own birthday. What inspired you to do that?
Yes, that is correct.
On your own.
Thank you. It was my birthday. 69 years old.
Happy birthday, Mr. De Niro.
Thank you.
You're 69.
Thank you.
Robert De Niro, very bad on radio, breathes directly into the microphone. Yeah. So here's a good example of marketing. Robert De Niro's birthday is coming up. I do a De Niro impression. I do it in Vegas. I do it everywhere. Everyone knows my De Niro. I thought, okay, I'm going to make a video. Robert De Niro's birthday party. I grab my camera. Since I have a video background, I knew how to shoot it. I have a monitor. I bought a little birthday cake. I improvised for 30 minutes. I cut it together with my editing software because I know how to do that, and I posted it. And in like a couple days, it had, 10,000 hits or whatever
it was.
Wow,
yeah, I saw it. You're like a schizophrenic. You become all these different
characters. Oh, I am schizophrenic, right, yeah. Right. The ladies love it.
Personalities, that's what it takes.
Yeah, that's what you got to be. You got to be crazy, folks. You got to be crazy. But yeah, so that's an example. Bane was another one. Bane from Batman.
Yes, hello there. I'm Bane. Your punishment must be more severe.
What was that?
I'll forget it.
I did a video of Bane saying that he was tired of Craig Ferguson being in repeats.
How do you get away with using these voices, and what do the actors say to you?
Well, Morgan Freeman loves it. Morgan Freeman comes up to me every time he's on the Late Late Show, literally. It's crazy. He'll walk over to me and say, Josh, how are you? Nice to see you. Boy, it's outstanding when you do my voice. That is something else. Boy, oh boy.
He can retire.
Yeah, no, he said, you're my vocal doppelganger. But you know what? Legally, good question. If you're doing impressions, as long as it's just comedy and parody, it's fine.
Right.
But if you're trying to sell something, the commercials I do in the UK where I use Morgan Freeman's voice, this guy gets, Morgan Freeman gets paid to not be in the commercial.
Right.
I'm sitting pretty. Because if they had him in the commercial, they'd have to pay him 10 times the amount they're paying him to not be in it. That's a position you want to be in.
Okay, let's monetize that. How do we get more to stay out so we can get you in?
I got Robert De Niro working on that.
Yeah. Perfect.
I got a couple of guys.
How come the Late Late Show doesn't promote your name, Josh Robert Thompson?
Boy, we're getting deep. Ooh, we're getting deep here on the Business Experience Show. You know, that's kind of the element of magic, I think. When you think about the Muppets, you think about Kermit the Frog.
Right.
I mean, I knew that it was Jim Henson. Like when I was a kid, I watched the credits and I'm like, who's Frank Oz? Who's Jerry Nelson?
Right.
Just passed. We just lost Jerry. He was the Count.
Yeah.
He's a wonderful performer.
The same for Elmo. Like when you finally see who's
Kevin
Elmo's
Clash.
Voice,
Kevin Clash is this, huge, African American guy. Hey man, what's going on? I'm Elmo. You sure you are? Anyway, you know what? I think it's just to keep the mystique.
Right.
Geoff Peterson is Geoff Peterson. And then I'll just get my own show.
Your website, JRT Voices, seems to have been taken over by podcasts.
Yeah, the podcast, the Poking Around podcast. That's a show I do with my buddy John Mariano. John Mariano was on Animaniacs. He played Bobby Pigeon. He's been on Sopranos. He's a great guy. Anyway, we do like this vaudeville. We do like a Martin and Lewis, Fire Sign Theater. How you doing? I'm 100 years old. These are all my references. But that's the kind of show we're doing. We just started season 2. It's on iTunes. It's on my website. And I love doing this show with this guy.
Josh, how are you taking all this talent and turning it into a business? You've been doing it since you're 5.
Yeah.
You're 37 now. What are you doing to monetize, build your business? Do you find that difficult?
No, not anymore. I think the key here is to definitely have a manager in your corner. I have a great, great guy.
And that really helps.
It really helps. Because you can do so much on your own, you really can, but to a point. This guy understands what I do. He understands the industry. He's been in it for many years as a manager. He's got big guys that he works with.
How do you go about, if someone is in your position and is an actor, does voices, what advice would you give to someone?
Why did it take you so long to get a manager?
Well, I think I could have hurried up on that myself. I think I kind of, was dragging my feet on that. But I also think that I was putting together a good reel or a good sampling of my work. I don't think I had enough under my belt to really go to the guy that I wanted to go to and say, hey, let's do something now. I think I have enough experience now. Because now I'm to a point in comedy where I can see something and say, yes, that works, or no, it doesn't.
Right.
That's a great ability to have.
Right.
And so my manager, he knows that. And he's like, we're going to have you write a book. We're going to do a show. We're going to do this, that, and the other thing. He knows what to do. And he knows who to call to make that happen.
So that must be very comforting now at with your career.
It is. I mean, you still have to do the work as a performer.
Sure.
You do your work. You do the creative aspect. And your manager takes care of, you know, setting up gigs and things for you. That's important.
Oh, absolutely.
You have to have
absolutely.
That. I mean, every one of these YouTube people... YouTube is brilliant because you think a lot of these homegrown kids mm-hmm. that are making all this money on YouTube came out of nowhere. You're going to find that a lot of those people already had managers and production companies putting their things together to make it look like they came out of nowhere.
Right.
To get more people using YouTube, which gets more ad traffic. It's brilliant.
Right.
It's really brilliant.
They've turned it into a business.
They've done very well.
Their mom, their dad, they've got production managers come to those guys when they see their traffic increase on that site. Josh, I would recommend highly that you start optimizing your own videos and come up with targeted messages for your clients and the audience so that it helps you get there. Now, I don't know how you're going to get 7 million to 100 million in the next few weeks. You got some work to do.
You know what? I think that the new video coming up is probably going to give us 200 million.
Yeah.
I think so. I got a really good idea that's coming up.
And you want to share that?
I can't share it because some kid in, Pawtucket's going to take it.
It's right. My idea, bro.
Don't do it. Don't do it.
When you post your videos, you go beyond the usual YouTube channel and really target some specific audiences. What are some of the other outlets you use?
Funnierdie.com.
Okay.
That's run by Will Ferrell and his director, Adam McKay. Those guys run that site, and that's another site where you've got a little older crowd
right.
that is more open-minded and a little intellectual, and they really get comedy. And you get a chance to be seen by some pretty big people over there. That's one place. Obviously, your Facebook and your Twitter.
Mm-hmm.
It gets exhausting, but it's great to just keep putting
right.
it out to the... Now, the other thing is to stay in touch with people.
Absolutely.
A lot of celebrities don't really communicate personally. I try to. Sometimes it gets scary, believe it. But I do communicate with them. I do answer the fan questions, and they really appreciate that.
Do you have your own social media footprint put in place?
Yeah, I mean, So, like, right now, my website is going to have, when you go to my website in the next few weeks,
JRTVoices.com,
right there, it will have all of my, Twitter, Facebook, everything in one spot. So you don't have to go searching all over the place.
Yeah, but that's great for the people to go find your
right.
messages. But how are you going to communicate back to them once they're on Facebook, Twitter, LinkedIn, those two particular sites?
Mr. McConaughey is going to do that for you.
Well, I'm sure. Oh, I mean, I'm going to sit there and, all right. I mean, I don't have nothing to do. I'm not making any movies right now. So when you're talking to Josh, you're talking to me.
If you set that up right,
yeah.
Whether it's McConaughey or it's you or
right.
whoever that may be, should only take you about an hour a day to check your messages if it's set up properly.
Yeah, that's a great idea. I know Twitter had something like that a while back I was using, but I would like to have a place where you could just...
There's a dashboard that you can get, and
is
I'll
there?
Share with you after the
oh,
show.
Oh, great.
Absolutely.
That's great.
Yep.
That's beautiful. Like
put
a
in
master
one message,
control.
Whatever it wants to be, send it out. It goes out to everyone. It'll also allow you to check to see who's actually sent you a message in the same dashboard.
Perfect. That'll cut down on a lot of time. Instead of, I'm going to take off Sunday to answer everybody's question.
That's exactly what everyone thinks they need to do.
Yeah,
right.
It's true.
No, that's really important information. What do you see, Josh, as the next readjustment for your career?
Readjustment.
The readjustment word. I love that word.
That's my manager's word.
Yes. Tell us about
He's brilliant.
Do you want to share that?
Listen, we don't call it a contract renegotiation. We call it a readjustment.
I love that.
I love this guy.
Yeah.
Because renegotiation really does have a negative connotation. The connotation is either you do this or we leave.
Right.
Readjustment is, no, we're not going anywhere. We're just going to fix it a little bit. No, the next move.
Readjust or die.
Readjust or die.
Yeah.
That's my new slogan. I have T-shirts for sale at JRTVoices.com. No, listen, the thing is I'm going to start doing more live comedy, tour. Working on an album right now, a couple of comedy albums, and that's what I'm doing. And then also, my own show eventually.
I love that. I love to follow you around. What's your tour going to be like?
It's going to be pretty crazy. It's going to be like the
share?
old, it's going to be the traveling variety show.
Oh, my God.
Conan O'Brien did something wonderful. Conan O'Brien hosted the Tonight Show for about 5 seconds. And when that ended, he decided, instead of laying around and being depressed, to go on tour. And he did. And they made a documentary called Conan O'Brien Can't Stop. And the tour, he basically brought a version of his show on tour. I think that's wonderful. That's like old variety shows of yesteryear, I should say. That's what we're going to do.
That sounds like a lot
John.
Of work.
Absolutely.
But
looking
it sounds
forward
fun.
To it. Sounds fun. It sounds great. Invite
yeah.
friends, guests, musical performances. People like that stuff.
How
really
do you
so.
Plan on marketing yourself while you're out on the road?
That's
we
a good question.
We need to drive traffic to that
Yes, we do.
Channel.
Well, you tell me.
Cole, how does he do it?
Everywhere he goes, he needs to have a some sort of document or sheet or something that has your YouTube, your LinkedIn, your website on it.
Right.
It's like a business card.
Right.
It's something that you pass out everywhere you go.
Yeah.
Post it in there. Ask the clubs to ask them if they can. You can leave it in there.
Right.
Post it up for you being there. Have them to sign it. Whatever. You want to leave your mark everywhere you can.
In the bathroom.
The bathroom. That's what I usually do in the stall. For a good time, call Josh. All right.
But seriously, offline, you can help market yourself online. It's not just an online audience that you get.
Right.
Those offline.
That's a great question for people that are like in the celebrity brand position. You know, Josh Robert Thompson, he's a businessman. He's in comedy, and he's a businessman. He's talent. So how do you put that hat on?
I mean, if you're serious, wrap your car or your bus in it.
What'd you say? If you're serious, what?
Wrap your car with your information.
Oh, right. Why not?
Well, I don't think I'm going to go that far.
You might be stalked.
It's just...
I mean, come on now. I'm already on TV.
Not on YouTube, bro. Yeah.
Who's this kid?
Yeah, but you don't have enough views.
Yeah, I know. You don't have enough views, but you're making 10 times more than I am. Yeah. Nobody cares. I don't know who this kid is.
There's a little known secret outside of Hollywood called ADR. Can you talk about your work with that?
Yeah, ADR, automated dialogue replacement. You know when you watch a movie on TV, if anybody does anymore, they have a censored version where they replace all the swear words.
Yeah, you do that.
They call guys in like me to do
that. Wait, to do the swear words or the opposite?
Well, the opposite. I'm kidding. To clean it up, you know. Fudge, that kind of stuff. Now, the other thing is Morgan Freeman. I do a lot of his stuff.
Yeah.
And I just worked on a movie.
Okay, but why would you do his stuff?
A lot of times actors have shot the film maybe a year ago, 6 months ago,
and they're not available.
They're off shooting something else. In fact, I did Mickey Rourke for the first Expendables. We cleaned up with some dialogue.
You did Mickey Rourke?
Yeah, he was put your thing up and just start talking like that. It's crazy.
He's got this thing as his face. You know, he went back to boxing after his movie career sort of ended. And he got his face all mashed in. They tried to do some cosmetic surgery. Now he's talking like this. It's crazy. You try to watch The Expendables, too. It's indecipherable.
My God. Time flies with you.
Last year,
you did a Western Playhouse reading, and the voice seemed a bit familiar. Do celebrity impressions creep into your non-celebrity voices?
Absolutely. Absolutely. I'm always taking voices. That's a good thing to do. As a voice actor, always listen. I have a whole collection on my computer of voices. People I've asked to speak into my microphone, record it, and keep it, you know?
Yeah.
Because then I use it later on for other jobs.
Right.
Yeah.
So we have just about one more minute to share the business experience show with Josh Robert Thompson. Josh, what advice do you give to someone who's following you, who's someone who wants to be like you, someone wants to be in, they're moving from Cleveland to Hollywood? If you could sum up how to make it a better business experience.
Don't step on my toes. Wherever you are, don't steal. You know what? Yeah, don't steal people's jokes. Got someone who just did that recently. No, you know what? I would say make sure that you really love what you're doing. That's key to all of this.
Right, I hear that. Don't, you have the passion for what you do.
Because YouTube is great, but there's this new generation that is like, we can do it all. And you know what? Be realistic.
Right.
It's great to have dreams, but honestly, be realistic. If you want to be a writer, write. Everything else will fall into place. Don't try to do 50 things at once.
Right.
Honestly, because I tried that. Pick one thing, do it. I do impressions.
Focus.
Impressions not my main thing, but I've made a career out of that, so I focused on that. That was the money-making
right.
thing.
Since I was five,
and that's led to everything else.
That's beautiful.
There you go.
Josh Robert Thompson, you can hear more on your website. Give your website and a voice.
JRTvoices.com.